Today's video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream is a subscription streaming service that offers thousands of documentaries and non-fiction titles from some of the world's best filmmakers, including exclusive originals. For example, right now, CuriosityStream is a cool six-part docuseries called Engineering the Future. It's about, well, engineering the future. It's the future engineering marvels of the 21st century and beyond. If you're a fan of my content, then I really think you like that stuff. CuriosityStream is available on many platforms. Web app, Roku, Android, Xbox One, Smart TVs, iOS, Chromecast, Amazon Fire, Amazon Kindle, Apple TV. If you've got a device with a screen, you'll be able to play it, and it's also available worldwide. Go to curiositystream.com/brainfood for unlimited access to the world's top documentaries and non-fiction series. And right now, for you guys, you can use the promo code BRAINFOOD to get 25% off the cost of an annual subscription, which comes out to just $14.99 a year. Not a month, a year. It's a great deal. Go to curiositystream.com/brainfood, 25% off, $14.99 for the whole year. And now today's video. On July the 21st, 1961, astronaut Virgil Gus Grissom climbed aboard his Mercury space capsule and blasted off the launch pad at Cape Canaveral, Florida, becoming the second American to reach outer space. Grissom proceeded to fly a near-textbook mission, splashing down in the Atlantic Ocean 15 minutes and 37 seconds after liftoff. But just when Grissom thought he was safe, his mission suddenly took a disastrous turn, resulting in him losing his spacecraft and very nearly his life. This is the story of the sinking of Liberty Bell 7, one of the most controversial incidents in American manned spaceflight history. On April 12, 1961, the space race between the United States and the Soviet Union entered a new phase as Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first human to orbit the Earth. On May the 15th, the Americans responded by launching astronaut Alan Shepard into the wild blue yonder. But while the United States had succeeded in putting a man in space, Shepard's 15 minutes of orbital flight hardly matched Gagarin's feet, and the American public clamored for NASA to move on to orbital missions. But the agency refused to be cowed and stuck to its relatively conservative program of incremental testing. Astronaut John Glenn, soon to be the first American to orbit the Earth, later defended this slow and steady wins the race approach, writing, "We were not in this program to perform great space feats, but to gather valuable information for the future. If we tried to interrupt or shortcut this process, we would not have proven very much in the long run. It was far more important for us to do it right, we felt, than to do it the first." America's second space mission, Mercury Redstone 4, would thus be a repeat of Alan Shepard's suborbital flight. And to pilot the mission, Robert Gilruth, director of NASA's Space Task Group, selected Gus Grissom. Born on April 3, 1926, in Mitchell, Indiana, during the Second World War, Grissom enlisted in the U.S. Army Air Force as an aviation cadet. However, the war ended before Grissom could see service, and after being discharged, he enrolled at Purdue University, obtaining a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering. In 1950, he re-enlisted in the Air Force and flew 100 combat missions as a fighter pilot during the Korean War, earning the Distinguished Flying Cross and the Air Medal. After returning to the United States, Grissom obtained a degree in aeromechanics from the U.S. Air Force Institute of Technology, test flying new fighter aircraft at Edwards Air Force Base in California and Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Ohio. In 1959, Grissom learned that he was one of 110 test pilots being considered for Project Mercury, the United States' first manned space program. After passing initial screening, Grissom and 39 candidates were sent to Lovelace Clinic in Albuquerque, New Mexico, to undergo a grueling battery of physical and psychological tests. Though competition was fierce, Grissom was ultimately selected for the program along with fellow astronauts Alan B. Shepard, John H. Glenn, Malcolm Scott Carpenter, Walter M. Wally Schirra, Leroy Gordon, Gordo Cooper, and Donald K. Deke Slayton. The Mercury 7, as they soon became known, were introduced to the public at a press conference in Washington, D.C. on April 9, 1959. And for more on the badass exploits of the Mercury 7 member Gordo Cooper, please check out our video, I'll Do It Myself, The Greatest Feat of Piloting in Space, on our sister channel, Highlight History. Following the example of Alan Shepard, who dubbed his capsule Freedom 7, Grissom named his own spacecraft Liberty Bell 7, even painting an appropriate white crag down the side of the hull. But while Grissom's flight plan would be nearly identical to Shepard's, his spacecraft featured a number of upgrades. In an effort to reduce the number and size of openings in the capsule's pressure hull, engineers and McDonnell Aircraft had originally provided the astronaut with only two ways of seeing outside, a pair of circular portholes and a retractable periscope. During his May 15th Mercury Redstone Redstone 3 flight, Shepard had complained of poor visibility. So for Grissom's flight, McDonnell replaced the portholes with a single trapezoidal window directly in front of the astronaut. The most important change, however, was the design of the capsule's hatch. Originally, the hatch was secured by 70 titanium bolts, meaning it could only be opened from the outside. In an emergency, the only way for an astronaut to escape was to fold back a hinged section of the instrument panel, collapse a bulkhead, and squeeze out through a narrow antenna compartment in the capsule's neck. This was less than ideal, so the Mercury astronauts lobbied hard for a hatch that they could open themselves. Thus, on Liberty Bell 7, the hatch retaining bolts were cross-drilled to weaken them, and a length of mild detonating fuse placed around the sill of the hatch. To open the hatch, the astronaut depressed a plunger on the inside of the hatch, detonating the fuse, shearing the bolts, and blowing the hatch clear. Other upgrades included a new rate control system for the capsule's maneuvering thrusters and joints on Grissom's spacesuit that made it easier for him to turn his wrists. Liberty Bell 7 arrived at Cape Canaveral from the McDonnell factory on March 7, 1961, and by early July had been mounted atop the Redstone rocket and made ready for launch. In the lead-up to the launch, Grissom gave up his favorite hobbies of water skiing and driving his car at high speeds to avoid being injured and pulled from the mission. He also expressed apprehension at having had insufficient time to practice on the maneuvering simulator or to rehearse emergency recovery procedures at sea, a concern that was to prove uncomfortably prophetic. Otherwise, however, Grissom felt confident that the mission would be a success. The launch was originally scheduled for July the 16th, but was scrubbed three times due to bad weather. The third time, on July the 19th, with Grissom already aboard the capsule and with just 10 minutes and 30 seconds to go before launch. But on the morning of July the 21st, the sky was clear and Grissom ate a breakfast of steak and eggs with his backup pilot John Glenn, donned his spacesuit, and was driven to the launch pad. At 8:58 a.m., Grissom squeezed into the cramped Mercury capsule and the hatch was sealed shut. Then, after a number of holds due to minor technical difficulties, at 12:20 p.m., the countdown reached zero. The Redstone's engines ignited, and Grissom and Liberty Bell 7 rocketed into history. While the liftoff was smooth at first, Grissom soon experienced increasingly violent vibrations that blurred his vision and made it difficult to read his instruments. But as the air thinned, this vibration soon died away and the rest of the ascent was smooth. 2 minutes and 22 seconds into the flight, the sky turned from blue to black, the Redstone's engine cut off, and the capsule separated from the booster. Liberty Bell 7 was now sailing freely through the vacuum of space. Just as he had practiced in the simulator countless times before, Grissom began testing the capsule's maneuvering thrusters, methodically rotating the spacecraft in roll, pitch, and yaw. Unfortunately, the magnificent view out of the new window distracted Grissom from his duties, so before he could complete his tests, it was time to prepare for re-entry. At an altitude of 190 kilometers, Grissom turned his capsule around, fired and jettisoned his retro rocket package, and lay back as Liberty Bell 7 plunged back through the atmosphere. The re-entry went flawlessly, with the capsule's automatic systems functioning exactly as designed. The only hiccup was a small L-shaped tear Grissom spotted in his main parachute, but this, thankfully, did not grow, and 15 minutes and 37 seconds after lifting off, Liberty Bell 7 splashed down in the Atlantic Ocean, 486 kilometers east of Cape Canaveral. It had been a near-textbook mission and another triumph for the U.S. space program. The moment Liberty Bell 7 splashed down, the recovery ship USS Randolph launched a Marine Corps Sikorsky H-35 helicopter, callsign Hunt Club 1, to recover the capsule and Grissom. As the helicopter approached, Grissom launched into his rehearsed recovery procedures. He unbuckled his harness, disconnected his oxygen, electrical leads, removed his helmet, and unfurled a special rubber neck dam to prevent his suit from flooding if he fell into the ocean. Finally, he removed the arming pin from the hatch detonation plunger and began writing down his instrument panel readings on the capsule walls using a grease pencil. Meanwhile, the Hunt Club 1, crewed by pilot Lieutenant James L. Lewis and recovery specialist Lieutenant John Reinhardt, were going through their own recovery procedures. Before the helicopter could hook onto the capsule, Reinhardt first had to cut away the 3-meter-long radio whip antenna protruding from the top of the spacecraft. This was accomplished using a tool called a cookie cutter, essentially a set of pruning shears mounted on a pole and powered by a set of explosive squibs. Once the antenna was trimmed, Reinhardt would use another tool called a shepherd's crook to hook a recovery line to the capsule. The helicopter would then lift the capsule so that the hatch sill rose above the waterline, allowing Grissom to blow the hatch. Reinhardt would then use the helicopter's recovery winch to lower a horse collar down to Grissom. Once Grissom was safely aboard, the helicopter would lift the capsule fully out of the water and fly it and Grissom to the waiting recovery ship. But as Hunt Club 1 attempted to trim the antenna, suddenly everything went catastrophically wrong. As Grissom later wrote, "I was lying flat on my back and minding my own business when suddenly the hatch blew off with with a dull thud. All I could see was blue sky and seawater fishing in over the sill. I made just two moves, both of them instinctive. I tossed off my helmet and then grabbed the right edge of the instrument panel and hoisted myself right through the hatch. I've never moved faster in my life. The next thing I knew, I was floating high in my suit with the water up to my armpits. But while Grissom managed to escape and swim free, Liberty Bell 7 was flooding and sinking fast. Aboard Hunt Club 1, Lieutenant Reinhardt threw aside the cookie cutter and reached out with the shepherd's crook, managing to hook onto the capsule just before it sank beneath the waves. Lieutenant Lewis then attempted to pull up, but the helicopter struggled to lift the heavy waterlogged capsule. Meanwhile, Grissom was running into trouble of his own. While he should easily have been able to float in his spacesuit, in his rush to escape the capsule, Grissom had forgotten to close an oxygen outlet valve on his thigh, causing his suit to slowly fill with water and drag him under. Worse still, the rotor wash from Hunt Club 1 kicked up tall waves that washed over Grissom's head. After surviving, rocketing past the edge of space and hurtling back to Earth at six times the speed of sound, America's second astronaut faced an ignoble death by drowning, and on live television, no less. While Lieutenant Reinhardt would normally have lowered the horse collar and lifted the struggling Grissom to safety, suddenly another emergency reared its head. As Lieutenant Lewis struggled to lift the heavy capsule out of the water, a warning light blinked on his instrument panel, indicating that he was about to burn out an engine bearing. Lewis had no choice but to order Reinhardt to cut the capsule loose and return to the USS Randolph before the engine failed. Liberty Bell 7 slipped beneath the waves, and Grissom, treading water nearby, could only look on helplessly as Hunt Club 1 pulled away and abandoned him. He said, "I tried to signal to him by waving my arms, then I tried to swim over to him, but by now there were three other choppers all hovering around trying to get close to me, and their rotor blades kicked up so much spray that it was hard for me to move. The second helicopter in line was right in front of me, and I could see a guy taking pictures of me through a window. At this point, the waves were leaping over my head. I had to swim hard just to keep my head up. I thought to myself, we've gone through the whole flight, and now you're going to sink right here in front of all these people." I suppose the crew did not realize how much trouble I was in. I was panting hard, and every time a wave lapped over me, I took a big swallow of water. I tried to rouse them by waving my arms, but they just seemed to wave back at me. I wasn't scared. I was angry. Then I looked to my right and saw a third helicopter coming my way and dragging a horse collar behind it across the water. As soon as I saw it, I thought, I've got it made. At long last, this helicopter, crewed by Lieutenant George Cox, the same pilot who had recovered Alan Shepard after his flight, managed to winch Grissom to safety. His harrowing ordeal was finally over. Popular retellings of this incident, such as the 1983 film The Right Stuff, often depict Grissom panicking upon splashdown, implying that either he or his recently removed helmet accidentally struck and triggered the hatch plunger. These depictions also show Grissom being treated as a pariah by NASA and blamed for the loss of his spacecraft. In reality, nothing could be further from the truth. While pilot error was initially suspected, this explanation was quickly ruled out and Grissom was cleared of all responsibility. Indeed, it is highly unlikely that Grissom would have panicked. Like his fellow Mercury 7 astronauts, he had been specifically selected for his natural coolness under pressure. Furthermore, had Grissom actually been blamed for the incidents, he would certainly have lost his prime slot in the NASA flight crew rotation, a slot which allowed him to become commander of the first Project Gemini mission, Gemini 3, on March the 23rd, 1965. In a classic bit of dark humor, Grissom named his spacecraft Molly Brown, a cheeky reference to the popular Broadway musical The Unsinkable Molly Brown. NASA administrators were not too impressed, and after Gemini 3, the agency banned astronauts from naming their spacecraft. This prohibition remained in place until the Apollo program, when the need to differentiate between the Apollo Command Service Module and Lunar Module led to the reintroduction of call signs like Apollo 11's Columbia and Eagle. But if Grissom didn't trigger Liberty Bell 7's hatch, what did? While the capsule was eventually located and raised from the bottom of the Atlantic in July 1999, close examination of this spacecraft failed to yield any clues as to the cause of the sinking. Investigators had hoped that footage from an onboard camera designed to record Grissom's reactions to his flight would reveal what was happening inside the capsule at the moment the hatch blew, but sadly, immersion in seawater for 38 years had completely destroyed the exposed film. What happens on that fateful day thus remains a matter of speculation. What is known is that Grissom could not possibly have triggered the hatch himself due to the particular design of the hatch detonating mechanism. The mild detonating fuse in the hatch was detonated mechanically using a firing pin and a percussion cap activated by the astronaut depressing the hatch release plunger. Ordinarily, this plunger was secured using a removable shear pin. With the pin removed, the plunger took 25 newtons of force to activate, with the pin still in place, 40 newtons. In both cases, this is too much force to be accidentally triggered by Grissom's hand or helmet. Furthermore, triggering the hatch caused the plunger to kick back violently against the astronaut's hand, leaving a telltale bruise which Grissom's post-flight medical examination did not reveal. Indeed, at the end of his Mercury Atlas 8 flight on October 3, 1962, fellow Mercury astronaut Wally Shearer deliberately blew his capsule's hatch and displayed the resulting bruise, vindicating Grissom once and for all. Today, there are two main theories as to what caused Grissom's hatch to blow. The first focuses on the capsule's emergency release lanyard, designed to allow recovery crews to blow the hatch from the outside in the event the astronaut became incapacitated. This lanyard was stored behind a small sheet metal cover on the capsule's exterior, secured by a single screw. According to this theory, the cover came loose during re-entry, allowing the lanyard to spill out and become tangled in the capsule's parachute shrouds. When the capsule splashed down and the parachute collapsed into the ocean, it pulled on the lanyard and detonated the hatch. The other major theory blames the recovery helicopter Hunt Club 1, whose rotors were known to generate large amounts of static electricity. According to a later account by Marine Corps Lieutenant John Reinhard, the man in charge of cutting Liberty Bell 7's antenna prior to recovery, Gus said that he was ready and we slid over. When I touched the antenna, there was an arc. Both squibs had gone off without my activating them, and they were on two separate switches. At the same time, the hatch came off. It could be that some static charge set the hatch off. Recent examination of enhanced recovery footage reveals that the hatch detonation did indeed coincide with the moment Reinhard touched the capsule with the cookie cutter pole, lending credence to the theory that it was static electricity from the helicopter and not Grissom which set off the hatch. Indeed, the only mistake Grissom made was arming the hatch mechanism before the helicopter had latched on and lifted the capsule, a procedure which was changed for all subsequent Mercury missions. However, in light of Grissom's ordeal, all but one of the remaining Mercury astronauts chose not to blow their hatches until the capsules were safely on the deck of the recovery ship. But whatever the actual cause, the loss of Liberty Bell 7 cast a long shadow over the US space program, one that would ironically contribute to Gus Grissom's untimely death. Grissom's prime slot in the crew rotation meant that he was chosen to command not only the first Gemini flight, but also the first Apollo mission alongside astronauts Ed White and Roger Chaffee. Grissom, however, was less than impressed with his new command. While the Gemini capsules, like Grissom's Molly Brown, featured fighter jet-style ejection seats, the new Block 1 Apollo spacecraft dispensed with quick escape mechanisms entirely and featured a hatch that opened inward into the cabin. This was done so the higher pressure inside the cabin would keep the hatch firmly closed and sealed. However, it also meant that in an emergency, it could take up to 90 seconds to open the hatch and extract the crew. The spacecraft's manufacturer, North American Aviation, had advocated for an outward opening hatch with explosive bolts like on Mercury, but NASA had pushed back, arguing that such a hatch could accidentally activate, just as it had on Grissom's 1961 flight. And so it was that on 1 p.m. on January 27, 1967, Grissom, White, and Chaffee climbed aboard their spacecraft at Cape Canaveral's Launch Complex 34 and prepared to perform a plugs-out test, a dress rehearsal that would stop just short of actually launching Apollo 1 into orbit. The astronauts were strapped in, the hatch sealed, and the cabin pressurized with 115 kilopascals of pure oxygen. The test did not go well, with endless problems with the spacecraft systems, especially the radios, prompting Grissom to grumble in frustration, "How are we going to get to the moon if we can't talk between two or three buildings?" But 1 minute later, a more alarming call was made over the radio. "Fire, we've got a fire in the cockpit. Let's get out, open her up." Faulty wiring beneath the astronauts' couches had ignited a small fire, which, fueled by the pure oxygen environment and the extensive use of nylon in the cabin and the astronauts' spacesuits, quickly engulfed the spacecraft. The searing heat and rapid spike in cabin pressure made it impossible for ground crews to open the hatch, and within a minute of the fire starting, all three astronauts were dead of carbon monoxide poisoning. The Apollo 1 fire sent shockwaves through NASA, forcing the agency to suspend manned spaceflights more than a year and a half and take a long, hard look at its priorities and safety procedures. In the wake of the disaster, the Apollo spacecraft and spacesuits were extensively redesigned to minimize potential ignition sources and the use of flammable materials. The capsule was also fitted with a new outward opening hatch with a compressed nitrogen-powered release mechanism that could be opened by the crew in only 5 seconds. The new Block 2 spacecraft first flew on October 11, 1968 on the orbital Apollo 7 mission, and with the notable exception of the 1970 Apollo 13 mission, and performed near flawlessly over 14 manned missions. But as is always the case with major human endeavor, this reliability came at a human cost, and the tragic story of Gus Grissom epitomizes the motto of astronauts everywhere: Ad Astra Per Aspera, a rocky road leads to the stars.